Well, in the wake of the deadly attacks here in Brussels, a lot of questions are being raised about security in Europe. In fact, former CIA director Michael Hayden says that the European Union sometimes gets in the way of its own security services. With me now to discuss it, Vice President of the Heritage Foundation, James Carafano, and also senior correspondent for Politico here in Europe, Ryan Heath. Mr. Carafano, let me begin with you, if I may. Let's talk a little bit about where European security failed, and are those gaps being addressed following last week's attack?
Well, the biggest challenge in Europe just seems to be capacity and capabilities, particularly in countries that have a large extremist laydown like France and Belgium. I remember meeting a couple of years ago with the French interior minister when the foreign fighters going from France and Belgium was really starting to peak, and he said, boy, we have a really serious problem here. We've got big numbers. We can't track all these people. We're worried about them coming back. So it's not that France and Belgium didn't know that they've got an expansive threat. I just think they don't have the capacity and capability to match it.
Well, okay, let's bring in Ryan Heath here. There's a connection between the Paris attacks as well as the Brussels attack. And in fact, former head of counterterrorism in the United States, Michael Leiter, was on our show this morning called Meet the Press, and he talked about that. Take a listen to what he had to say. Yeah.
This is the first time since 9/11 that we have had a cell or network in the West conduct an attack, and then it survives to fight another day and launch another attack. And this is after 4 months of intensive investigation.
This has never happened in any other incident. We're usually able to eliminate.
What are your thoughts on that?
Well, let's imagine conservatively that there are several dozen people in this one cell. And there could be more, because we know there's at least 120 trained fighters, ISIS trained fighters, who've returned back into Belgium alone in the last 2 years. Now, normally it would take between 10, 15, potentially up to 20 intelligence officers to properly monitor each one of those people who could be involved in planning a terror attack. The Belgian services have a total of 700 people in their whole security service operation, and many of those positions are vacant at the moment. So there's absolutely a capacity issue, that's for sure. But there are coordination and data management issues as well. Now, some of that is naturally obvious. There are 28 countries in the European Union. It's going to be more complicated to share the information across languages, across borders. But there's massive gaps in how they do that. Ministers are frequently criticizing Belgium when they get together in Brussels, for example, not securing airports properly. And then thirdly, you have a situation where there's simply no data management. Sometimes names are entered incorrectly. In the case of illegal weapons in Belgium, there's literally no data. There is no way to know how many illegal weapons there are in this country, let alone the bomb-making facilities. So at every level, the authorities are behind the game.
Yeah, incredible. So much European integration in some areas, still not in others, particularly on the intelligence. Mr. Carafano, let's talk a little bit about the U.S. in terms of what it may have learned following a number of these different terrorist attacks that have taken place on European soil. What do you think the U.S. is learning, watching, developing in terms of its own strategies at home?
Well, this is a really important issue because the European threat is different than the American issue. And I think it's very, very a huge mistake to kind of conflate them. We have a much more disparate threat in the United States. You know, so, for example, radicalization in mosques. We don't see a lot of terrorist activities in mosques. Terrorists are smart enough to stay away from them. If you look at the laydown across the communities in the United States, it's arguable that we even see a lot of activity in Islamic communities. As a matter of fact, some of the people that have radicalized the United States are Christians, and they've literally decided, I'm going to be an adherent of ISIS, and they either do material support or they go over there. So it's a very more disparate laydown in the United States. It's a very different threat. And I think we have to focus, when we're looking at our domestic security, on the threat that we face and not look at Europe and do some kind of mirror imaging.
So I know, Mr. Carafano, you've written a little bit about this. What are some of the questions facing security professionals in the U.S. then, and what's next and how to stop it?
Well, for the United States, it's two parts. One is keeping bad people from getting here. I mean, we've had 85-plus Islamist-related terrorist plots aimed at the United States since 9/11. The overwhelming number have been thwarted. For every Boston or Dallas or Fort Hood that maybe somebody's heard, there's 10 plots that were foiled. And what stopped them was good counterterrorism, good information sharing. And the other thing is an amazing diversity of these plots. Increasingly, what we're actually seeing in the United States are actually homegrown, people who are developing here in their own little cells and organizing that. We're actually not seeing as many connected to physically connected to somebody operating overseas. So it's a hard target to get here. We need to keep doing that. We need to be screening to make it a more difficult thing for get here. But then much of it really goes down to the local level and the cooperation between state, federal, and local law enforcement, looking for signs of a potential plot and then getting in there and investigating it appropriately.
Let me pick up on that point that Mr. Carfano just raised. You know, you've lived in Europe a long time. You know it very well. The U.S. is urging European Union officials to bolster their kind of cohesive security. Why is it such a challenge for them to do it when they all recognize this is a problem that affects all the member states of the EU?
Sometimes it's about the wake-up call. So let's dial back to the U.S. before 9/11, for example. It would have been harder to make those arguments in that environment. After 9/11, it's a no-brainer. You just have to do it because you're simply irresponsible and negligent as a government if you don't do it.
So is now, this a 9/11 moment for the EU?
This is Belgium's 9/11 moment. Okay. Yeah. Now, I'm not saying I'm not equating the scale necessarily, but for Belgium, it's going to have the same sort of impact. And for the French, who already had a better operation, Paris is having a similar impact. And so it's taken 15 years for the US to get to the point where it's at now. It's going to take a little bit longer for the Europeans to catch up. Unfortunately, that's not going to be any comfort to anyone or the families of people who lose their lives in the meantime.
All right, Politico Europe's Ryan Heath and Heritage Foundation's James Carfano in the US, thank you both for joining us and thanks for your insight.